Isn't God good? You know, we've been singing a new song the last 2 weeks. It's a new song. I don't think we've sang here at the church before. And Zach and the team have been leading us through that new song, God is Good. And I don't know about you. I love that. It is. God is good. He is a good God. He's never going to let me down. He's never going to let me down. It just gets in your spirit. And I know that Jesus is so... has to be so close to all of us to get that into our spirit. But sometimes we let him down. You know, he never lets us down, but sometimes we let him down, don't we? And so this morning, I want you to turn to a passage we're going to spend time on. My message is in Luke chapter 15. Sometimes this is known as the gospel inside the gospel. There's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Those are the four gospels. And this is sometimes referred to as the gospel within the gospel in Luke 15. And would you just, off the screen today, would you just read my title to my message? It is, what is
our mission?
What is our mission? You know, it's good to be reminded what our mission is. And Luke gives this mission very clearly. Jesus is going to do some teaching here in chapter 15 of Luke, and we're going to jump into that here in just a moment. But the world that we live in is very diverse, isn't it? People from all around the world, there are many different cultures. I've had the privilege the last 10 plus years traveling and seeing all the different cultures in our world, and people are so different. Matter of fact, look right to the people next to you. Go ahead and do that. Just look at them. They have different hairstyles. They have different clothes on. They have different eye color. They're different. We are a diverse group of people. And matter of fact, the church, you sitting here today, you reflect diversity. We're all different. I can go to the mall today if I were to go to the mall. I have not been to the mall for some time. But if I were to go to the mall today, I could just sit on a bench and just watch people. I love to just watch people. That's me. Now, you would say there are two types of people in this world, okay? Two types of people. Let's see. Let's see. Two types of people, okay? Oh, my. Oh, my goodness. I need to fill up. Or are you, I got this? Now, let's take a survey real quick. Who would say, oh my goodness, I need to fill up my car? Raise your hand. Okay? Now, who would say, I got this? Yeah, see? About half and half. Now, I will tell you, and my wife will testify of this, I got this. We have ran out of gas multiple times on the highway. I'm dead serious. Ask her. And not only on the highway, but in the boat as well. One of the worst experiences we had, this is before we had kids, we were on the Ohio River in Pittsburgh. You know, you have the Allegheny and the Monongahela, and they formed the Ohio. And we were on the Ohio River, and about 50, let's just say it was more than 50, but it's probably about 500 yards from the point, there is a spillway. There's a lock, they're called, where they raise the water up and down for the barges. And I ran out of gas. And we're floating towards the spillway, which is not a good thing. What do you do when you're out of gas on a boat? You probably should put down your anchor, but I didn't have the anchor. Now, I share that to say this. I was in trouble, so I had to call somebody. I'm glad we had a cell phone back then, you know, so I pulled out my bag phone, right? Some of you are familiar with the Motorola bag phone, and I didn't know who to call, right? I called 911. I said, I have an emergency. I've ran out of gas, and I'm floating down the river. And needless to say, if I would have called, like, River Rescue, like, to get towed in, it would have cost me, like, $200 or $300. But because I called 911, it didn't cost me anything. They said there's a stupid person floating down the river that has no gas. And so they saved us, and they pulled us up to our dock, and I was able to load the boat. I got this. That's okay, so there we go. I mean, it's pretty obvious that we live just within this group of people sitting in the sanctuary today. We are different. We are diverse in so many ways. And it's amazing that Jesus came for all of us. It doesn't matter what your background. It doesn't matter what you've been through. It doesn't matter what you've walked in today with. Jesus was on a mission for all of us. Now, I will tell you something about Jesus and his ministry. Wherever Jesus went, there was a crowd. Wherever Jesus went, there was people. It is a powerful thing we see in the New Testament. When Jesus was doing ministry, people flocked to him. It was amazing. And the amazing thing about this is that these large crowds that gathered around Christ, these people were nothing like Jesus, but they liked Jesus and he liked them back. They were nothing like Jesus, but they liked him and he liked them back. Now that is something amazing we see that our God in his mission, it didn't matter if you agreed with him or if you didn't, he still cared for you. He still valued you in a great way. And matter of fact, just so you know, guess what? Us as the church are his body. We are his body. And what was true about Jesus personally, what is true about him personally probably should be true about us collectively. Wouldn't you think? If people mattered to Jesus, and he got along with people that didn't like him necessarily, or was like him, shouldn't us as a body represent that? Yeah, we should represent that in so many ways. You know, Jesus used different adjectives to describe people. It's funny. I want you to turn there, if you would, this morning to Luke chapter 15, if you would. If you have your Bible, some of you have an electronic Bible. We do put it on the screen for those that are lazy, right? Now, it's like, where's my Bible? Oh, there it is. It's up on the screen. I brought it this morning. And so Jesus used different adjectives to describe people. And some of those are in verse 1. And I want to read verse 1, chapter 15, verse 1 to you real quick. It says, now the tax collectors and sinners. Tax collectors and sinners. These were describing, let's just stop right there. These are describing in the New Testament some bad people. Some people that necessarily didn't believe what Jesus believed. Sinners themselves. Any sinners in the house? Yeah, we're all sinners, saved by grace. Amen? Okay, so there we're labeled. Have you ever been labeled before? Ralph, if you didn't read book, Ralph Goldsmith's book, he talks about being labeled and how God defines you in your identity, not somebody else. Are you with me? And so we've all been labeled different things. We've all been called different things. And there's been different adjectives that describe maybe who we are as individuals. And Jesus does this when it comes in the New Testament. There were tax collectors and there were sinners. These people did not necessarily, like I said, believe what he believed. And then we have the next group of people, which is a blast in verse number 2. But the Pharisees and the teachers, so now we have two other sets of people. We have the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. They muttered. Now, we don't use that word all the time, do we? Have you ever muttered before? Okay. Can you believe that? Can you believe she said that? You know, we muttered. So they're muttering. This man welcomes sinners and eats with them. How dare he? How dare he do this? They don't believe what he believes, but Jesus liked them, and he spent time with them. And do you think the people that are not sitting in our church today, the people that are outside our four walls, do you think they feel the same way as the sinners and the tax collectors of that day, where they could get around and feel welcomed and feel valued and cared for? It's a good question to ask ourselves. It's a good question. You know, let's talk about people for a second. Don't we like to do that? We like to talk about people. We live in a world that, again, that can be. You can label people. You can think of different objectives that that describe people. What are some of these examples? Well, I did something like most of us would do. Okay, what are these? Let's take a look. So I did a search on the internet, adjectives to describe people, and this is what I came up with. There's a big long list, and we'll jump back into the scripture here in a second. These are some of the positive ones. Okay, and so let's just go through this for example. The neat thing about when you see these words, this is for me anyhow, when I read these words, I immediately, as soon as I read a word, I think of somebody. I think of the person's name, and their face immediately comes into my mind. Isn't that interesting? That we label people and think of them like that. Because every time I read a word, affectionate. Wow, we had Valentine's Day on Tuesday. We had maybe some affection, right? You know, might have bought some roses or did something special, take your loved one out to eat or something like that. But when I think of affectionate, I think of my dog. No, I'm serious. Now, Ashley, are you in here yet? There she is. I love my wife. She is affectionate as well, but my dog is very affectionate. No, I'm serious. Now, listen. Our dog is so affectionate, he doesn't know when to stop. Like, you like, hi, Bogey, how you doing? He will pick your hand up and make you pet him. He wants constant attention. We have to go to therapy, I believe, because it's constant. He wants affection constantly. So when I saw that word this week, affection, well, Bogey popped right into my mind. I don't know if that's proper. I think my wife should be there first, But my dog, I mean, he just overdoes it. Okay, so when you think of affection, I'm serious. There's something or someone that points to your mind. Agreeable. When you think about someone that's agreeable, it comes to your mind. Somebody the opposite agreeable maybe comes to mind, right? Now, when I think of the word calm, immediately, I don't even have to think about this one. Glenn Cobb comes to my mind. I've been overseas with Glenn. And somebody can cut off their arm, and he's like, it's okay. We got this. He is so calm. He's like the one you want to have around when you're in an emergency. It's just so true. I love it. And it's probably because he was a firefighter and he's seen everything under the sun, but it is so true. And then we got creative, you know, those creative people like Deborah Wallen. She's, you know, artist of the month down the road, down at the Green Dog, right? And so, you know, creativity, it just comes natural. It's there. So if you get a chance, you know, stop down and see her paintings and the things that she's done. They'll be up for another few weeks down at the Green Dog, just down the street here in the plaza. Creative, energetic. Oh, I think of Zach. Zach, you're so energetic, you know? He's like, yeah, you know, he's ready all the time, you know, immediately. And I'm not going to go through all these, you know, and label people, but I think of hardworking. I think of Herb Goldsmith. Talk about hardworking. I don't think the sun comes up or goes down without him working a full day. So those are people that just come to my mind. I think of reliable. You know, there's so many people that are reliable that you can maybe just, it comes to your mind. And so I think of Paul. He's at that door every Sunday. You're reliable and greeting people and welcome people into the house of God. And so there are adjectives to describe all of us. Okay, now let's go to some negative ones. Those were all positive, by the way. Oh, no. Bossy. Oh, who's bossy? Who's bossy? Anybody bossy who wants to claim that one, right? How about clingy? Anybody clingy? I have a daughter that's 8 years old that's just clingy. And we love it, actually. We love it. It's like my one son, I only have one son, so Luke, he's not clingy. He can be the hermit, you know. He could just enjoy life in his room if he wanted to, and we coach him out, but Anna's clingy. Anybody moody? Anybody want to claim that one? No one wants to claim. Oh, so, okay, some hands are going up. How about sarcastic? No. You're not sarcastic. Anybody? Yeah, I mean, because we have stubborn. Anybody stubborn? Yeah. I didn't think you were stubborn. No. unreliable, we don't want to claim that, lazy, all these. Okay, so these are negative ones. These are, again, different adjectives that describe people. And here in this passage, we have adjectives to describe who was in this crowd. We have the Pharisees. We have the teachers of the law that think they're perfect. This is the way you serve God. You get up in the morning. You dare not put the coffee on before you pray. You know, that's just the law. They were very focused on the proper way to serve God. And then you had the sinners and the tax collectors that are just out there, but they were drawn to Jesus because Jesus did something that we need to reflect as a church. That is, he valued people. He valued people and where they were. He didn't force something upon them. This is what you must do. No. There is a vibe, or there is a climate. Everybody say climate. Isn't this a beautiful climate? 72 degrees in February. What in the world? It's beautiful. It's beautiful. It's so beautiful. The Lord directed my steps on Friday to go play golf. It was beautiful. It was the Lord's will. The Green family was not doing well. Had to go visit them because they weren't all up to par. Right? You've heard that one before. But it's the climate can be beautiful. But listen, the climate in which you produce as a person. Hear me. The climate in which you produce as a person is so powerful. When somebody gets around you, what do they feel? Hello? What do they feel? Do they feel on edge? Do they feel like you're just going to like attack? Do they feel like you're a waste of time? Or do they feel like you care? Or how do they feel? Your climate and what you produce around you, listen, is so powerful to the mission that God's called us to be. Englewood Church, I love the DNA here because we have diversity in our group. It's true. There are people in here that come from all walks of life. And our desire here at Englewood has been a place, and I think our DNA has been that this is a climate where people feel like they believe or they can belong even before they believe. They can belong. They can be a part of our body because we value something. We value who they are. And we're going to talk about what this all looks like when it comes to our mission. Our climate matters. And Jesus had a climate that accepted those that not necessarily were like him, but they liked him. Church, we need to be a church like that. And when I say church, I'm not talking about just this building. I'm talking about you as an individual. You need to produce a climate that people are like, I want what that person has. I don't know what it is. I don't know what they have, but I want it. I want to be a person like that. When I was a teenager, and I grew up in church, okay? But when I was a teenager, there was this guy in our church. He was just like a happy fella. He had the joy of the Lord on him all the time. I was like, what's this guy on? You know, seriously. Why is he so happy? Why is he so like giddy about Christ? He had this climate about him that people were like, I want what he has. And I got to know him. And really, the Lord used him to sharpen me for something. Sharpen me for something that needed to be developed. And that was a care for people. People matter, don't they? You ever lost something? Yeah, we've all lost something. Yeah, you all lost against the Steelers. That's not in my notes. That's not in my notes. Listen. You've all lost something. Okay? You've all lost something. Have you ever lost somebody before? On purpose? No. Have you ever lost somebody before? On accident? Yeah, we've all lost something. I've taken many people on missions trips, and one of the places that you really don't want to lose somebody is in a city that's like 12 million people, right? In New York City, I've had teams of 150 people. That's crazy. And it's like, this is an orientation. This is what we teach. Listen, if you ever get lost, stay where you are. Do not go anywhere. Stay where you are. Because if we love you, we will come back and get you. It's simple as that. Keith, you've been on orientation with me. That's what I say. If you get lost, stay where you're at. If we love you, we'll come back and get you. Okay, that's how it works. But I've been in a place where I've lost my daughter. We were at Disney World. Have you ever been there? And she disappeared. And I was in immediate panic. Where'd she go? You know? So Ashley, like, which way did she go? We didn't know. She was gone. Well, what do? You forget about what's not lost, and you go find what's lost. So who cares about Luke? Your attention gets, who's lost? What's lost? I've lost something by accident before, okay? And there's been times where I've lost people on purpose that follow me, you know, trying to, you know, not necessarily on purpose, but I'm sure some of you maybe have, right? Running away from something or whatever, you know? I remember, I probably shouldn't say that. I remember not getting on a school bus one time and hiding in the woods, trying to get lost on purpose, right? We've all been there. Has anybody ever been lost from their group before? Raise your hand. Yeah, some of us. Some of us have been somewhere where you've gotten lost and not where, you know, nowhere, no one to that you can relate to. I've been in that situation myself. I've flown into a country where somebody was there, supposed to be to pick me up in Peru, okay, and they weren't there. I did not know anyone that was in the airport and sat there for 4 hours. And I will tell you, when you're in a different country and you don't speak their language, and you know no one, and you have no contact to call anybody, it can be a scary place. Being lost is not necessarily fun. When we were, some of you might remember, or some of you might know this, but the church property has they have a White House. It's not the one on Pennsylvania Avenue, unfortunately. But we do have a White House. It's on Lee Summit Road on a piece of property. And when we first moved here, my wife and I and the kids, we stayed in the White House. We were only there for about 6 months until we sold our house back in Pennsylvania and got settled and all that fun stuff. And so we were there, and Ashley was at a women's retreat. She went to this women's retreat, and I had the kids. And at that time, Luke was probably about four, three and a half. Anna was just one years old. And I was feeding her. And Luke decided, this is when we had Divot, our other dog. Luke just decided to put my shoes on and take Divot for a walk down Lee Summit Road at 3.5 years of age. Without my knowing. And I'm feeding Anna inside the house. And all of a sudden, I get a very hard knock on the door. I'm like, who is that? I'm like, who's knocking on the door? So I go, and there's this lady that just, is this your son? I'm like, oh, yeah, it is. And she labeled me very clearly with objectives of who I was. And I thought I was going to get the call, right, you know, from the Child Protection Agency. Because my son was halfway down Lee Summit Road in my shoes walking the dog at 3.5 years of age. Have you ever lost something and didn't know it? That was me. That was me. And so I was at a place where that was foolish on my part. Let's go into these three lost things. There's three lost things here that Jesus is talking about in this passage in Luke chapter 15. What does this do with us? Why does it have to do with our mission as an individual, our mission as a church? Three lost things. The first thing he talks about is the parable of a sheep that was lost. And let's just read it. Let's say verse number 3 or 4, actually. Suppose one of us or one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Everybody say, go home. And then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me. I found my lost sheep. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over the 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Jesus, what are you telling us? Now, in our culture, if you had 99 sheep and one was missing, in our culture, we could almost say, we have 99. It's not that big of a deal. That one is probably gone already. No biggie. But in that culture, it meant their livelihood. It meant everything. We're leaving those 99. Why did Jesus use this parable? Because he could relate to the crowd that was there, and the people who were there were understanding who shepherds were. Now, do we have any shepherds in the house this morning? Probably not herding sheep. No. Now, you shepherd your kids, right? You have to corral them in and do that. Some of you are bosses, and you have to do those things with your employees. But Jesus understood the crowd he was speaking to, and he touched base with the shepherds. And he said, listen, you would leave the 99 to go get the one. Are you with me this morning? Okay, so that makes sense. Let's go to the second parable. So Jesus, he shared this next story. Let's look at it in our passage here. There in verse number... There we go, number 8. Let's go to 8. And this is the parable of the lost coin. Suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light the lamp and sweep the house and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin. So here we have a lady. Now, back in those days, they couldn't just turn on all the lights in the house. They didn't have that electricity, right? Excuse me. They couldn't do that. So she had to use the lamp, and she had to sweep, and dirt floors. You have to picture yourself in this situation. It was not an easy task to find this coin. Now, let's catch you up what this means in that culture. In this culture, a lost coin could represent a whole day's wage. Now, if you lose a whole day's wage, would you probably not look for it? Of course you would. But some of us in our culture, if we had 10 quarters and lost one, we'd be like, no biggie. No biggie, I got this. But in their culture, it made a big deal. So no wonder she's looking for it. Well, that's why Jesus was relating to the culture. And here's another thing you need to understand about that time. Ladies, anybody got a ring, got a bling? Anybody? Got a new one? Anybody? Okay, some of you got rings, right? Ladies, if you lost your ring at the mall, would you call your husband up and say, hey, honey, I've lost my ring, but it's okay, I have my cell phone. No, you're going to look for that thing, right? And in this culture, guess what they did? When you were either in waiting or you were married, they wore a band with 10 rings. It was a signature of the fact that you were either in waiting or you have already been taken, okay? Depending on how that was designed. And there was usually 10 coins in this band, and she lost one. More likely, that's what this story is relating to. And guess what? If you lose your ring, ladies, you're going to look for it. And you're going to find it, hopefully, right? No wonder this lady would have been excited, and no wonder Jesus shared this parable with the crowd that was there. He was relating something. If you lost something that was valuable, would you go find it? Of course we would. And here's another thing I want you to see about this story that represents something powerful. When you lose a coin, better yet, if you lose a Benjamin. I've never lost a $100 bill in my life. I haven't. I've never carried one. I've had them before, but mine said goodbye. I don't have them in my wallet, okay? They're not there. I don't even have a wallet. There you go. So the deal is, if you lost it, you would try to find it. But here's something about that coin. Just because it was lost, it never lost its value. Just because it was lost, it was still valuable. Jesus is doing a powerful teaching here to say, listen, just because you're disconnected from the other 99. Just because you're disconnected from the 10, you never lose your value. You better go find it. Jesus is setting the foundation for something that is called the gospel. Let's go to the third parable. Jesus shared with the crowd. And this is found. This one's found in Luke chapter 15, the following verses after chapter verse number 10, I believe it is. So let's go there. And I'm not gonna read it word for word. We'll jump in back at verse number 20. But here we have a son. Anybody have a son? Raise your hand. I have a son. Some of us have sons. Okay. So I'm the baby of the family. Matter of fact, there's three older brothers I have. I'm the baby. Okay. So I'm the youngest. So I fit this parable very easy because it was the youngest son. And so the youngest son went to the dad and said, "Dad, I know you have all this property. I know that, you know, someday I'm going to inherit it." Matter of fact, in that culture, the youngest only got 1/3. Okay. It's just the reality. The older brother got 2/3. That's how it was set up. Not necessarily fair, but, you know, it was a reality. And so he knew he was only getting 1/3, but the reality is he wanted the money. He wanted the property before his dad passed away. Is that selfish? Yeah, pretty selfish. Pretty selfish. Pretty greedy. And so he goes and makes this deal with his dad. Said, "Dad, just liquidate your assets. Now, listen, you know, I don't want to get to the point where, you know, you never die, right? And so just give it to me now." And this is what Jesus was teaching in this parable. This son bribes his dad, convinces him to give him his assets now. And then the son decided, "I got freedom." And so he went to another land and just blew it. I mean, he was buying cars and he was staying at five-star resorts, right? He was gambling. He was just living uptown. And what happens in this story, he loses all of his money. He's broke. He's desperate. Anybody broke and desperate? Don't raise your hand. This is the situation this guy finds himself in. He blew it. And we pick it up. We pick it up in the passage here where we see the son finally came to his senses. And when he came to his senses, he realized something. He realized that he was in bad situation. He had no food. The Bible says there was a famine. He had no food, and he thought to himself, listen, I know that the people that work for my dad, the slaves, they eat better than I'm eating right now. I'm going back home, and I'm just going to apologize. I'm going to ask my dad for forgiveness and ask him to be a slave at the farm. That's what he says. That's what he's saying to himself. Listen to this. The son was gone relationally. Listen, the son was gone relationally before he ever left home. He was. The relationship was over before he ever left home. But the son was overwhelmed because he was disconnected and he was lost, right? He was disconnected and lost. And so he decides to go home. And we see this in verse 20. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. And so he ran to his son. He threw his arms around him and kissed him. And he said to him, "Father," this is the son, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put on the ring on his finger and the sandals on his feet," which signifies authority and acceptance. "Bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let's feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is found." So they began to celebrate. It's a beautiful story of God's love for people. See, our Father is just like this Father that Jesus was sharing about. No matter what you've done, no matter how selfish you've been, if you turn back to God, he has his arms wide open. Something the son was wondering, the son was missing home. But he didn't know if home was missing him. And if there's ever people in our community that need to know something, they're missing home. But they struggle if home's missing them. We need to be a place, a church, Englewood, where we represent a home that's missing now. We have to be a place with arms wide open like Jesus was and tell the people like he did in this crowd, you have a place with me. We need to see people as Jesus sees people. The Father desired relationship. There are two types of people. We showed all those pictures at the beginning. Two types of people. Some of you wanted to fill your tank up. Some of you said, I got this. But listen to me. There are two types of people in this world. There are the connected that represent the 9 coins, that represent the 99 sheep, and there are the disconnected. That's the only two type of people in this world. They're either connected to Jesus or they're disconnected. Jesus was concerned about the disconnected, and he approached it in his ministry in that way. Abraham Lincoln once said this, and this, he was asked this question, actually. He was asked how he was going to treat the rebellious Southerners when he had finally been defeated and he had returned to the Union in the United States. The question was expected that Lincoln would take the dire vengeance, but he answered this. He said, I will treat them as if they had never been away. Talk about grace. That was from a president. Talk about grace of our Father in heaven. He has incredible grace for those that would come back. You know what's interesting about these three parables? They're all different. They're all different. There is a difference in each of them. The sheep was lost through sheer foolishness. He didn't think about it. Isn't it interesting that God relates to us as sheep? Some of us just don't think about it. We just wander off. So the sheep is just lost because he's foolish. And then we see the coin. The coin was lost through no fault of its own. Many are led astray or they're tempted. Okay, you follow me? Completely different situation. So we have a foolish sheep and we have a coin that has no fault of its own but is lost too. Okay, and then the third we have is a son that deliberately went lost. So these are three things that are lost, but completely different stories. Thank you, God, for addressing three different stories because we're different people. See, we all have different stories, and we all have been lost in different ways. But the story is all the same at the end. God still has an open arm, and he still accepts us. So listen, church. Listen, church. I want to ask you a question. What is our mission? What is our mission? Let's put the answer up. The answer says? Yeah. Let's stand across this room this morning.